few phenomena are as impressive as a total solar eclipse, when the disks of the sun and moon, as seen from Earth, perfectly align. But why should those two disks be the exact same size? Astronomers tell us that it's a coincidence, but multiverse physics provides a better and smarter sounding explanation. Since the probability of the solar and lunar disks being exactly the same size is literally astronomically small, the only possible explanation is that in alternate universes where the two disks are different sizes, there aren't Earthlings asking questions. That is, if the solar and lunar disks weren't the same size, there wouldn't be intelligent life on Earth. But how did eclipses make intelligent life possible? Any book in the growing literature on eclipse addiction will tell you that what makes total eclipses stand out among natural phenomena is the phenomenal amount of awe that they inspire. Eclipse addicts are awe junkies. Awe is associated with a part of the forebrain called the striatum that responds to both pleasurable and aversive stimuli. When the striatum receives signals of both elation and fear, and warring impulses toward approach and avoidance perfectly cancel out, and we just stand there shaking, that's awe. I propose that this neurological standoff causes trauma at the cellular level, leading to a wave of tissue damage that propagates through the entire forebrain. Tissue damage is bad, but as any marathon addict can tell you, when traumatized tissue heals, it gets bigger and stronger than ever. Indeed, one study showed that chronic inflammation can lead to increased synaptic plasticity. I hypothesize that this cycle of repeated eclipse-induced traumatization of the human brain gave us the huge forebrains we have today. Now, some of you may point out that brain cell trauma has no impact on germline cells and hence cannot drive evolution. But let me remind you of the equivalence principle of post-neo-Darwinian evolutionary theory. For every evolutionary hypothesis, H, that has the un-Darwinian, Lamarckian feature of assuming that acquired characteristics can be inherited, there is a more complicated Darwinian hypothesis, H prime, that is functionally equivalent to H and equally undisprovable. I call my theory of the evolution of human intelligence the Wonder Tuffins Forebrains hypothesis, though for some reason, many of my colleagues object to this name. The process of eclipse-driven brain growth doesn't have to end with us. Neuroanatomist Michelle Hoffman suggests that bigger brains will yield information processing benefits up to the point where the human brain is two or even three times as large as it is now. But total eclipses are becoming rarer and shorter and will someday cease entirely because the moon keeps getting farther away. If my theory is correct, at some point, we should start to see the human brain get smaller as the effects of eclipse-induced awe begin to wane. Guess what? We're already there. Average brain size has been decreasing over the past 28,000 years, and I think you can all guess why. We'll employ a mathematical technique called Lagrange interpolation, which specifies the unique polynomial of degree n minus 1, whose graph passes through n specified data points. Let's take 2. Two points of brain size data. And perform Lagrange interpolation obtaining the unique degree one polynomial that fits the data. Now let's do the same thing for eclipses, where eclipse dosage is defined as the proportion of the time that a spot on Earth is in the zone of totality. Note that if we rescale the vertical axis, the fit with the brain volume graph is perfect. Tragically perfect. So it might seem that our future looks more like this. But I say that this need not be our future. How can we restore eclipses to what they were in the evolutionary heyday of humanity? Pull the moon closer? Bah! I have a much more practical plan. To make eclipses great again, we don't need to make the moon closer, we just need to make it fatter. Because the moon always presents the same face to us, we can increase the diameter of the lunar disk by using moon stuff to construct a prosthetic bulge along the meridian, separating the near and far sides of the moon. And this bulge doesn't need to be wide as long as it's tall. So I say, let's build a wall all the way around the moon, blocking the sun's light. Total solar eclipses will then last longer, occur more frequently, cover more ground, and do a better job of bruising our brains into increased size and intelligence. The lunar wall will be a lot easier to build than a similar wall on Earth. The moon has lower gravity, little seismic activity, no wind, and no chance of ownership skirmishes of land with well-armed Texans. That we know of. The cost is about $250 billion, which may sound like a lot, but a log plot puts the price in perspective. In logarithmic dollars, the cost of the lunar wall is less than twice the cost of the US-Mexico border wall. Here's the best part. 20% of the moon's substance is silicon, which is also the main ingredient in solar panels. This wall won't just block light. It'll harness light to power the lunar economy. The profits from the lunar economy will be sent back to Earth to reimburse us for the construction costs. Do you see what I'm saying? The Moonikins will pay for the wall. Finally, to those who fear the outcome of such a large-scale project, when our current level of scientific knowledge gives us no way of assessing possible unintended side effects, I say this: you've proved my point for me. I mean, you wouldn't even know about these causal links if humankind hadn't done these large-scale experiments. Right? How will we ever learn how nature works unless we mess with it? Thank you.